Hello and welcome to Civil Engineering Mathematics A, Program 6. My name is Eric Chun. I'm a lecturer at Central TAFE. Well, this is going to be the third program on algebra. You might wonder why so much time on algebra. Well, algebra is really the cornerstone of anything you might be doing in engineering, whether it is working out a force in a beam, or perhaps working out a drilling angle, or finding the resistance in an electrical current. So we continue with algebra. In fact, we'll be continuing with the topic of solving equations. We'll be looking at solving two equations, and then we need two unknowns. We'll also look at formulae. Let's look at the screen and see exactly what we're going to do in this program. The first topic will be then on simultaneous equations. We then look at the formulae, very important in engineering. We look at how to substitute value in formulae. Then we look at transposing formulae, that is changing the formula around. And we then finish with some practical problems dealing with formulae. Now, in the last program, we had one equation, one unknown. And we solved, or we could solve them, they're called linear equations. In this program, we look at a system of equations. We look at two equations with two unknowns. And generally, you can solve those as well. And in fact, in higher algebra, you might come across three equations with three unknowns. Let's have a look at an example there. If I've got an equation such as x plus y equals 10, then you'll find that there are many possible solutions. I've got some written here, x equals 5, y equals 5, because together that adds up to 10. See, that's sometimes written as what's called an ordered pair, 5, 5. There are other solutions, and I've got another one there, 0, 10. Also, those two numbers add up to 10. And again, that's written as 0, 10. So we don't see a unique solution for x and y. However, if I now going to introduce another equation like this one, x minus y equals 2, there generally will be a unique solution. And in fact, in this case, the unique solution is x equals 6 and y equals 4. You can check that in. 6 plus 4 is 10, and of course 6 minus 4 is equal to 2. Notice again this way the solution is written as an ordered pair. What we say is that we've solved a pair of simultaneous equations. Now there are various ways of solving simultaneous equations. Some are easy, some are more difficult. In fact, many calculators nowadays can solve these equations for you. You of course have to know what to put into the calculator before you get a result, but yeah, that could be regarded as one method. But generally there are about four methods, and I've got those listed on the screen. The first method is called substitution, the second one elimination, the third one using determinants, that's to do with matrices, and then there are graphs as well. Now the substitution one is probably the most difficult algebraically. The elimination one is the easiest, but you have to rewrite equations in a particular format. Determinants, for those people who are good at matrices, it's a very easy method. It's called Cramer's rule. We haven't got time for that in this subject. And as a graphical method, that's not always exact, and that we will cover in the next program. And then, as I mentioned, of course, you can use a calculator as well. I'm going to give you now an example of these two methods we concentrate on, the substitution and the elimination method. So here we go. There we've got that system of equations, as it is sometimes called, x plus y equals 8, x minus y equals 2, and that is what's sometimes used to keep those two equations together. The equations are numbered quite frequently as well. And with the substitution method, what you do is you express one variable in terms of the other. Now, I've taken equation 1 and I've rewritten that as y equals 8, and I've transposed the x to the other side, 8 take x. Then we substitute that in the second equation. So rather than writing y now, I write 8 minus x. And then I end up with one equation in one unknown, which can be solved. in the usual fashion where we combine the two x's there and we bring the negative x to the other side, 2x equals 10, from which we get x equals 5, of course. And then I can use the third equation there to get the value for y, because I know that y is 8 with 5 subtracted. In other words, y is equal to 3. Let's now do the same problem using the elimination method. So here we go. Again, number these equations 1 and 2. And what you do in the elimination method, you put the two equations underneath each other and you try to eliminate one of the variables. In this case, you would add the two equations together and then you add in columns. So you get an x and an x there, 2x, and you'll find that the y and the negative y will cancel out and the 8 and the 2 will become 10. And of course, from that we get straight away x equals 5. Once you now know that x equals 5, we write that down. Then again, you write down the two equations. And in this case, we can eliminate the x by subtraction. And if you subtract, and that's the difficulty there, you're going to get to 2y. Because what you do is you get y subtract negative y. So that becomes y plus positive y, which is 2y. And that's where, of course, the mistakes are made. And that equals 6. And from that, we get y equals 3. So the solution again is x equals 5, y equals 3. Now both methods are fine. What I suggest is that you use a sort of a combination of the two methods. What I always do is I do the substitution method last. I first start with the elimination method. I get one of the variables and then I use substitution to get the full result. And that's what I've got here on the screen. So the suggested procedure is to write the equations in the form ax plus by equals c. Use the elimination method to obtain the value of one variable and then you use the substitution to obtain the value of the other. Straight into that same problem as we had before. See, exactly the same equations. And first eliminate. And we've got 2x equals 10, from which we get x equals 5. And then I use either 1 or 2 by substitution to get the second value. I use x in 5, x equals 5 in the first equation, and from that I get 5 plus y equals 8, from which we get, of course, y equals 3, written 5, 3. There was a lot of information there, and perhaps you should take a small break before we do some more examples. Let's have a look at some examples using these suggested procedures. As usual, some easy ones first and then a more difficult one towards the end. Simultaneous equation problem 1. Here we've got two equations. They both got a 4y and a negative 4y. So in fact, if I want to eliminate, then I should use addition. And that's what's done over there, because the 4y and the negative 4y will cancel out. And 3x plus 5x is 8x, and of course 6 plus 2 is 8. From that I get x equals 1. Then we continue and we substitute the x equals 1 in equation 1 in this particular case, and I get 3 times 1 plus 4y equals 6. 3 plus 4y equals 6, or 4y equals 3. And then from that we get y equals 0.75, and the solution can be written as x equals 1, y equals 0.75, or I can write it in the ordered pair notation. Then we go on with problem 2. That's a little bit more difficult, as you can see, because there, by adding or subtracting, nothing is going to be eliminated. In fact, we have to do a little trick here. What we do is we multiply equation 1 by 2, and as soon as that becomes multiplied by 2, everything will be multiplied by 2. So I will get the 4y I want. I get 10x plus 4y equals 4. And I get still the same equation, the second equation, negative 7x subtract 4y equals 2. Line underneath, add them up, and the 4y's will cancel out. I end up with 3x equals 6, from which we get x equals 2. Then we substitute the x equals 2 in either equation 1 or 2. I've chosen 1. 5 times 2 plus 2y equals 2. 10 plus 2y equals 2. And we get 2y equals negative 8. And from that we get y equals negative 4. Remember, it's negative 8 divided by 2 to get negative 4. And this is the way I've written my solution, x equals 2, y equals negative 4. Now we're going to look at a more difficult example again, that's example 3. And there we might have to multiply one equation by one factor and the other equation by another. Let's have a look. In this problem there's in fact another complication, because the second equation isn't written in that form where you've got x's plus y's equals a number. In fact, the first one isn't written like that either. So that's the first thing we have to do. We have to rewrite the equations. The first equation becomes 3x plus 5y equals positive 7. Change sides, change signs, remember. And the second equation becomes 2x plus 6y, because I changed a negative 6y to the other side, becomes plus 6y equals 2. The 2 is already on the right-hand side. I've numbered the equations. And now you see I have to multiply one equation, and chosen 2 in this case, by 2, and the second equation by 3, because that way I get those coefficients the same. Here we go. That's what I've done. 6x plus 10y equals 14. 6x plus 18y equals 6. That is the second equation multiplied by 3. Now I've got 6x there and 6x there. I must subtract to eliminate. That's done over the page. I have subtracted there. And here we go. 10y subtract 18y is negative 8y. And 14 subtract 6, of course, is 8. From that we get y equals negative 1. Then I use either equation 1 or 2, in fact I can use 3, to get the other equation or the other value. I get, I've chosen 3 there, 6 times x plus 10 times negative 1 equals 14. Simplifying gives me 6x equals 14 plus 10, and that equals then 24, and from that we get x equals 4. Rewriting it as a solution, x equals 4, y equals negative 1. You will agree with me that this was quite a difficult problem. A lot of things you had to do, rearranging, then the elimination, then the substitution. Now sometimes we have 3 equations and we got 3 unknowns, and then the process becomes even more difficult, and perhaps then it's time to grab the calculator and let the calculator do the work. Now, like in linear equations, we looked at word problems. Well, we're going to do the same with simultaneous equations. Sometimes there is a sentence there and you have to distract the mathematics from it. Word problems, I've called them. Simultaneous word problems. What you should do is, you should try to minimize the number of variables. You should use logical variables. It's basically the same process as with linear equations. You end up with 2 linear equations, and then you use the methods just described to solve. Let's have a look. The procedure I've indicated here is to determine the unknown quantities and choose logical letters. You write the equations and you solve the equations. And then, of course, you have to answer the problem using the correct units. Let's stay on the screen and then move on to problem number 1. Probably a very simple one. Yes, it is. A rectangle has a perimeter of 22 meters. The difference between the length and the width is 3 meters. Find the length and the width. Well, here we let L be the length and W be the width. And so I can write those two equations now. I know that the perimeter is 2 lengths plus 2 widths, and that must be 22, and the difference must be 3. See, we write them underneath each other like that. And now I notice that I can't add or subtract to eliminate, so I will multiply the second equation by 2, so I can eliminate. And that's what's done here. 2L plus 2W equals 22, and 2L minus 2W equals 6. On the next screen, that's repeated. I even drawn a picture there of a rectangle, and we add them up because we want to eliminate W. When you add them up, you get 4L equals 28. From that, of course, we get the length equals 7. And because I know that the length is 3 more than the width, I should be able to tell straight away that the width is 4. But I've substituted the value L equals 7 into this equation. And after some simplification, I get 2W equals 8, from which we get W equals 4. The last thing I have to do is to write down the solution in the correct units, 7 meters by 4 meters. Now we have a look at one more example, and I'm not even going to work it out. I'll just show you how difficult it sometimes is to come up with these equations. The solving is probably the easiest part. Example 2. Here we've got a farmer. He has sheep and emus. He counts 92 heads and 194 legs. How many of each does he have? That's a simultaneous equation problem. Doesn't look like it. Well, 92 heads. Let S be the number of sheep. Let E be the number of emus. Now, a sheep has a head. An emu has a head. So if I add, well, I've done the legs first here. I've looked at the legs first. A sheep has 4 and an emu has 2. So I get 4 lots of S plus 2 lots of E being equal to 194. And then, of course, the S plus the E equals 92 for the heads. And I've said here, put the largest on top because it's easier mathematically. Well, the solution comes to 5 sheep and 87 emus. But that was perhaps not the most important thing. The most important thing, the most difficult part, was to actually put it in equation format. We'll have a short break and then we'll come back with our next topic, formulae. Well, the next topic in this program is about formulae. It's one of those modules. You know, remember, the whole course is divided into modules. This is a separate module. Very important in engineering, and engineering lecturers always insist that students know how to use formulae. Most famous formula, E equals mc squared, you know, from Einstein. What does it mean? It means, just like it does in algebra, it's m multiplied by the square of c. C, in fact, is the velocity of light. Well, I've got some examples here of formulae. First of all, it says here that, of course, formulae are used a lot in engineering and computing and science, and some examples follow. Pi r squared, we already used. F equals m times a, that is Newton's formula. We've got an interest formula, PIT divided by 100, and there we've got what's called the quadratic formula. Now, you don't have to know anything about these formulae, you just have to know how to, first of all, evaluate them, and secondly, how to transpose them. Now, what's meant by evaluation? By evaluation is meant the substitution of values into the formula to get an answer. That's a relatively straightforward process. I've got some examples. The first evaluation problem is quite easy. It is an area formula, and we've got L equals 5.2, B equals 3.1, calculate the area. Very easy. In this case, I get 16.12. Perhaps the only thing you want to note about this problem that I give my answer to one decimal place, because the values there are given to one decimal place as well. We move on to example 2, a little bit more difficult. This is a formula used for the accumulated sum in interest payments. R is the interest, which is 2% in this case, and N is the number of years. The principal is 2,000. Again, you don't have to know anything about these formulae. You have to be able to substitute them in. That's what the purpose of this unit is. So I've substituted 1 plus 0.02 and I raised it to the power of 5. That means multiplication, that 2,000 in front of the brackets. If I do that on the calculator, I get this particular number with all these decimal points, places there. It's a money problem, and money problems are generally given to 2 decimal places, to the nearest cent. We move on to problem 3, one more. And there we've got the quadratic formula, which we will encounter later, perhaps, in the course. We have to substitute the values. A equals 2, B equals 7, C equals negative 4 to find values of X. That's quite difficult. A lot of students have difficulties with that. Here we go. We substitute the values, and that plus and minus will, in fact, mean that we get 2 solutions. We get 7 squared, subtract, and this is going to be difficult. That's a negative and a negative. That makes it positive. 4 times 4 is 16 times 2 is 32. So underneath the square root, I should get 49 plus 32. In fact, I get this equation. 7 plus or minus the square root of 49 plus 32 over 4. Turning to the next page, there I've got it split up. I've worked out what 49 plus 32 is. That is, of course, 81. And now I can write it as 7 plus or minus 9 on 4. In fact, I get 2 solutions. I get the x equals 7 plus 9 equals 4 if I use the plus in the equation. Or I get the x is 7 minus 9 divided by 4, the minus of the plus and minus. So I get 2 answers. And working that out, I get 16 on 4. and the other solution gives me -2/4. In other words, I get x = 4 or x = -2. Now, you can't do engineering or mathematics for that matter if you don't know how to apply that formula which we've just discussed. It's called the quadratic formula, and later in a course on engineering you'll come across that many, many times. And sometimes, of course, you have to start rounding. This was quite a nice problem. Now, what we frequently have to do when we have formulae is to transpose the formula, to rewrite the formula in a different format. If I want to program a calculator or a computer, I would have to do that. So we have to be well trained in that. Let's have a look. Transposing, that's what it is called. In transposing, what we do is we change the subject. In a formula such as f = m(a), we actually call f the subject. It is the letter that's on its own, if you want. And to make another letter the subject, you transpose or you solve the formula. So, for instance, if I have f = m(a), I could write it as a = f/m, and now that is the subject, or I could write it as m = f/a. Now, the process for doing this is very similar to solving algebra equations. I've got an example there. If I had to solve in algebra 2x + 7 = 15, and I have to solve that for x, and I compare that with, for instance, c = 2b + h, solving for b, I go through the same steps. See, for the first line, I rewrite the equation, then I transpose this 7 to the other side to make it 8, so I end up with 2x = 8. In this case, I want to transpose the h, and I end up with c, subtract h = 2b. From this I get 8/2 = x. A little bit more difficult, of course, with these letters, but the same operations apply. If I want to get b, I have to divide the whole left-hand side by 2. I get c - h/2 = b, and that's all I can do with my transposition. I can certainly calculate that x = 4, but I can't do anything here. That is the end. That is the transposed version of this formula. As usual, let's have a look at some examples. Here we've got problem 1, that's a problem used in mechanics. Phi = u + at, we must make t the subject. So rewriting that, we transpose the u to the left, it becomes a minus u. Then I divide by a, and I get phi - u/a = t, rewriting it perhaps. That's the transposed version, phi - u/a. Second problem, where we've got the formula for the perimeter of a rectangle. We know we want to evaluate w given p = 18 and l = 2. So I want to transpose first before I can evaluate what w is. That's what I'm doing right here. I write it as 2w = p subtract 2l. I've transposed the 2l. In other words, I then divide by 2 to get the transposed version of the formula. Now it's just a matter of substituting 18 in there, and 2 times 2 there becomes 4 to get the answer of w = 7. Let's have a look at number 3. This is indeed a little bit more difficult. This involves the square root. Now, to undo square roots, you square, and that's what's done here. I've squared that term, but I first transposed to 2a, and so I end up with 2 times p a, because I multiply the 2a by the p, equals the square root of 2r minus phi. Squaring both sides gives me 2pa all squared equals whatever was underneath the square root. Then we turn to the next page, and we multiply that out, difficult one, that becomes 4p² a² = 2r - phi. Finally, transposing that leaves me with the transposed version of the formula, substituting the values that were given into the formula, and that gives me the value of 100. Well, this brings to end program 6. I want to show you where that is covered in the book. It is done in chapter 6, simultaneous equations, and in chapter 7 on transposition and evaluation of formula. You will have noticed that at the end of each of the programs we've made reference to a website. Well, for enrolled students that's a very useful site. It contains further examples and some more explanation. Well, I hope you enjoyed studying Program 6. I'm looking forward to your company in Program 7. Bye for now.